This lecture is a part of the paper on gender, media, and society. This lecture will help you understand the concept of education viewed as a source that changes the liberation and education as a tool for empowerment. Till just a few years ago, gender and change were largely absent in the agenda of education and invisible to policy makers. They were completely marginalized in the entire social political process as well. The great consciousness that the process of development can lead at quantum leap only when the status of women is elevated in society seems to be a relatively recent realization. Gender relations are a social construct, a construction of power to legitimize and marginalize the gender. An individual in such environment is socialized right from the beginning to imbibe the stereotypical social roles without questioning the legitimacy of existing hierarchies and authority. There exists immense pressure on both the sexes to live up to the established norms. The perpetuation of unequal gender relations in society stunts the development of intellectual capacity among both sexes. Hence, it is in the very interest of both men and women that they are liberated from the existing social subjugation. The issue of gender gaps across all disciplines and is a significant factor in determining gender relations. Several studies have pointed out that even these institutions play a significant role in perpetuating and reproducing such inequalities, stereotypes, and discriminations through biased behavior, gender insensitive infections. The practices to women outside the classroom, teaching, such as in the playgrounds or during visual signs, also influence the learning outcomes of girls and girls. Thus, concerns about gender equality must be understood not only in terms of access but also in terms of children and ways of teaching. It has been increasingly realized that education should be gender first and the girls of the incentive curriculum must be that a gradual paradigm has begun. The purpose of ideas of gender issues and their inclusion into the curriculum is structured by expectation within the educational institutions. Instead of confining gender issues to the fringes of the marginal education process, which isolates it, they should be brought to the forefront of the educational mainstream. This is crucial for the development and empowerment of women, and those under the level of confidence and solidarity. Marxists and socialist feminists often argue that the inequalities of gender in the system of education needs to be viewed in a broader context of capitalism. In a capitalist setting, the educational institutes were either state ideological operators that ensure the relations of collections. took note, the body makes the listen and therefore godless, not only when the assembly of spirit taken by godless, they step up in the labor market, but with the appropriate attitude and strength. Hence, it is vital to evaluate how educational distributions provide and equal experiences of the students based on their biological background. These similarities encompasses two individual females in their communities. Significant study in the number of female figures as well as sex species according to them with an ease in their third lives. The sibling child representation of gender 0-3 types with women being sent as females and men as girls. Girls going outside and girls going inside. Fathers going to office and mothers staying at home. Perpetuating archetypical gender attributes such as women are passive, self-sacrificing, emotional, caring, etc. While men are active, strong, logical, etc. Although several attempts have been made to improve gender sensitivity within the curriculum and Indian culture, yet much work needs to be done still. The initiatives adopted so far are merely directed at potential mention about women in every discipline. For instance, history only talks about few big women, namely Roger Chopin, or Rami Nitsubara, or Nidhi. Similarly, science textbooks might perfunctorily mention about Valkyrie or Neptune. The discipline of economics is another case in point. According to the neoclassical economics, the all economic actions are performed by a wealthy individual, a man, who necessarily acts to maximize his profits. Another problematic proposition is that all economic actors are defined in terms of the market, which leads to gross oversight of the production carried out by women outside the market for household consumption and the unpaid labor that they contribute for the function of the economy. A unitary model of household without any recognition of the gender-based inequalities in inter-household resource allocation is another major signifier of gender insensitivity of the mainstream discipline. Lack of gender sensitivity is endemic even in mainstream sociology. In that much of the focus of this discipline lies in certain factors, such as class, tribe, culture, class, family, and certain processes, such as sensitization, modernization, decimalization, etc. Women and sexist forces also have not been completely missed out, but cannot be called as feminist in essence either. This is because the social structures and processes are not construed as gender entities themselves, conveying distinctly different meanings and experiences for men and women. For example, in an ECDIT society textbook, the mention of human sex ratio is not found in the chapter on population and demography. It is one of the most important indicators, whether it is the women or subsection of women in a chapter on the tribe. Political science is yet another distinctly masculine discipline where mainstream theories only focus on politics in the context of political parties, elections, and in a whole alliance. Transformation of institutions of culture. The Bible calls the person the question of gender. A very small space is given to women, but too early in the form of such responsive discussions as women's empowerment, reservations for women, especially in the context of 72nd and 73rd Amendment Article. However, there are compelling reasons to expand the definition of political to include three new areas of equity, many of them involving women as legitimate areas of state. These are firstly, political experience and impacted upon differently by men and women. Secondly, it is important to explore how political processes alter gender dynamics. Thirdly, women's participation in political activities follow different pathways from those to men and which need to be suppressed and separated. Among the social changes, gravity seems to be the most impervious to gender analysis and reflection of marriage. According to feminist geographer William Jewish, geography is one trying to propound the brain theories for explaining global processes and states. Actually, reflect the perspectives of the world, the social, and heterosexual needs. This has been quoted by feminist geographers who argue that gender is not incidental but central to the production of geographical knowledge. For instance, the mainstream masculinist geographic and skewed states are undifferentiated in terms of gender, but feminist geographers have pointed out that space is distinctly gender. Science subjects have been treated for their focus on objectivity. As the starting premise of polarization and exclusion of any subjective notion of social inequality, including gender. And other social inequalities, whether the objective sciences towards the masculine mind are his as hard sciences, implying that these are for men, while the subjective disciplines of men, psychology, history, sociology, are understood as soft sciences. That is, these are for men. Objective scientific methods are justly, genuinely, and smoothly. There are several problematic postulations building the pursuit of scientific inquiry. For example, scientists terminology claims that women were intellectually inferior because of their lighter gaze. The fact that projections of body size were ignored indicates that the processes of science are not free from bias. To comprehend given that it cuts across disciplines and is fundamental to the production and communication of knowledge. The gender stereotypes upon gender attributes and roles are generalized and transmitted to language. Already, the strength of such messages render the letter as convincing and impossible to learn. Sexism pervades language. It penetrates its morphological depths, stylistic conventions and assumptions to something as common and everybody as it generally is as men to designate all humanity. Constructing gender is together taken. The emphasis on curriculum reform has become evident. From the formulation of national education. existing policies and reciprocating development. Definitely. The overall culture of the society in terms of gender equality would encourage the world in which not only the girls and their families, but also the teachers and the educational institutions do the value and relevance of education programs. For example, sometimes nutrition, nursing, etc. may be considered as suitable for women and girls. Why? Mechanical, civil engineering may be considered appropriate for boys and men. Stereotypes such as this also inform the teaching process, and girls are often compelled to opt for subjects which are less studied in the market. Because women are supposed to be taken care of home and family. Otago and Boy furthermore to be across both the developed and developing world. Girls have indeed gained entry into schools due to collective national policies, advocating universalization of education. However, this has not ensured that they have equal access to the curriculum and the power that is related to certain types of knowledge. Volumes of literature point towards the need to introduce gender sensitivity in school curriculum, some positive change in the gender social practices across the world. However, such advocacies tend to mostly pertain to quality of education rather than on gender. Nevertheless, changing curricula is a difficult task because it is convinced that some subject matter experts, credentials bring a lot of engendered ideologies to the process. Further, the fact that curriculum are owned by the state means that questioning the curricula implies challenging the state, which itself is embedded in the theoretical approach. It must be remembered that learning must be facilitated in such a way that kids from poor and marginalized backgrounds can be empowered to transform the world. In this context, the language of instruction is also important because girls and women often have less access to and use of mostly of the school's languages that men. Children learn about gender roles and stereotypes from the images and illustrations in textbooks and use utmost care need to be given in abuse in developing learning materials. Methods of evaluation must take into consideration the fact that girls may not be always directly assessed to different examination systems. Rather, methods of continuous evaluation through greater teacher student interaction and participatory activities may be used. In India, the National Commission for Women constituted an expert committee in 2010. To deliberate and suggest ways for reorienting the education system of the country so as to bring about positive attitudinal changes towards gender equity and equality. The report of the expert committee clearly highlighted the need to change the syllabus to promote gender sensitivity and legal awareness for the protection of women. Accordingly, the textbook syllabus must include specific laws for protecting women, so that students are not only equipped with life skills, but also learn to respect the law. This could be done right from the primary classes to the high level according to their capacity, with priority for the person given to the right leader to change the current environment. Of course, such restructuring of the curriculum must be done in consultation with definite structural committees. Representatives of the new and celebratory departments, human rights experts, etc. The committee also agreed with some valuable recommendations regarding inclusion of women's human rights concerns in the curriculum. These include paying attention to class and gender-based violence, disparaging discriminatory practices against women, extensive use of visual media in textbooks, as well as films and documentaries, strong messages of gender justice, specifically unlisted principles which signify gender sensitivity before revising textbooks, allowing space for women from vulnerable sections, etc. Sensitizing the teachers. Where is the classroom teaching and learning now? It goes without saying that the curriculum, however progressive, needs teachers who are themselves alive to the issues of being. Themselves equipped to understand and explain these to young people. Teachers are not only responsible for delivering knowledge, but also facilitating learning. The effectiveness of an inclusive curriculum undoubtedly depends on whether it is taught in the classroom. This also includes interactions within the classroom, practices such as encouraging the girls to speak up, investing as much energy in the girls as much as the girls in the class. A gender equitable approach to schooling must underscore the following issues. The perceptions of masculinity and femininity that are ingrained in the minds of the children coming to school, and these stereotypes about gender identities are acted out by them in the school. The gendered ideologies about appropriate masculine and feminine identities communicated by the school centers to the children. The incorporation of gender equality as a priority requirement that each school should expect from the teachers. Developing a comprehensive strategy for disseminating gender equitable ideologies to different programs in the school. The expert committee report, instituted by the National Commission for Women in India, has come up with important recommendations for the government to build the capacities of the teachers. In delivering and facilitating gender, best advocacy. These include providing the teacher trainings for pursuing B.Ed., D.Ed. degrees, with appropriate information aimed training on gender as issues, imparting gender human rights, training to teachers, concerned officials, staff, including education officers on the board, and district education officers, district education and training institutes, etc. To ensure periodic reviews of the gender sensitivity and training programs at least once in 2 years. Conclusion. Summing up this lecture, inclusion of gender issues into the communication studies curriculum would build women's voices, narratives, experiences, and worldviews into the academic mainstream. We learned that the inclusion of gender issues in the discipline of communication studies will not only lead to the holistic development of the students, but will definitely emancipate them and will provide them with a better understanding of exactly. But in these terms, we forget about individual and global representation of women. In population of issues relating to women's status, dimension, and role, elimination of sexist bias and stereotypes, and causing research in areas which are significant in the advancement of knowledge explains the information bias, dissemination of information to websites, seminars, and critical evaluation of existing techniques. Hope you have enjoyed this lecture. For more details, please read the context of the lecture properly and attend to questions.